host of migrant university lecturers, students, researchers opposed to the hostile environment policy, which is a 10-year policy of internal borders within the UK that has turned regular people into border guards and has emboldened a surveillance apparatus on migrants, asylum seekers, refugees, and undocumented and underdocumented migrants within the UK. Within the UK higher education system, the hostile environment policy is practiced through intrusive attendance monitoring checks to both migrant university staff and students that most recently has been streamlined to include all staff, whether British and migrant, so as to not appear outrightly discriminatory towards migrant students and staff in particular. During the 2 years of the COVID-19 pandemic, and of course, we're still in the pandemic mode, unfortunately, another aspect of draconian border regimes within UK higher education can be seen in migrant students who have been unable to pay their tuition fees, which has in turn resulted in them being forcibly withdrawn off of their degree courses, causing their student visas to be curtailed by the Home Office and effectively being deported out of the UK before they can complete their studies. Of course, this issue isn't just isolated to the UK alone. Another group that we've been working with and who has been doing work during the global pandemic in Canada is called Migrant Students United. And they were, I think, established in the last 2 to 3 years. And they have documented similar cases to the ones that we are seeing in the UK during the global pandemic. URBC continues to document many of these cases of migrant students withdrawing, being forcibly withdrawn and deported because of the financial issues that they are facing, which unfortunately is still continuing to this day. So it hasn't really ended. It's still something that we do see routinely, the type of casework that comes our way. 2 years into the pandemic, URBC and Migrant Rights Network did a small scale study and found that in the first couple of months of the COVID-19 pandemic, 56% of migrant students in the UK reported as either being destitute or at risk of destitution due in part to the woeful lack of support structures within UK higher education for migrant students. In addition to how immigration barriers, such as no recourse to public funds, has created this precarity. Meanwhile, Universities UK International just recently congratulated themselves for meeting an early recruitment drive of 600,000 migrant students for the 2022-2023 academic year. With the reintroduction of the graduate student visa in July of 2021, previously called the post-study work visa, which was removed in 2012 during the first days of the hostile environment policy, this scheme will allow migrant students the ability to work 2 years in the UK. Both UK higher education and the Home Office are essentially luring migrant students under the guise that after graduation, they too can start to earn money in the UK. But it goes without saying that migrant students are being used by this visa scheme partially to cover the loss of EU labor since the finalization of Brexit and the end to EU free movement. More importantly, the introduction of the graduate student visa scheme does not provide any incentive to migrant students who have been forcibly withdrawn off of their course for being unable to pay their tuition fees and are still grappling with debt, insecure immigration status, and are hampered by barriers as a result of the hostile environment policy. Currently in the UK, we have concluded 7 days of a 10-day strike called by University College Union, UCU, that began on the 14th of February. The strike's two main aims are one, to stop pension cuts, and the other is to fight for better working conditions within UK higher education. And this is known as the Four Fights campaign, which includes to close the ethnic and gender pay gaps, pay that matches inflation, a new workload management, which includes a 35-hour work week, and a framework to eliminate precarious employment and an end to casualization. And if you're coming from North America, what we mean by casualization is the adjunctification of higher education. While these are central problems that UCU members are taking strike action to push back on the harms that marketized higher education continues to cause, migrant staff and student issues still factor very low within UCU actions and discussions on precarity, even while UCU uses the hashtag one of us, all of us during the strike to connote the shared struggle of staff and students. However, the erasure of national strike demands to end the hostile environment policy, much less a real commitment to push beyond just motions and words on ending the oppressive counterterrorism policy, such as the prevent duty that is disproportionately targeting Muslim students and who are both migrant and British inside higher education, shows that there's still issues that the strike could actually be addressing, as well as the Four Fights campaign and also to end cuts to pensions. Moreover, as UCU members are striking to end pension cuts, there is a lack of discussion, much less activism, on what pension investments are actively doing and what kind of funds these are contributing to, whether it's funding settler colonialism in Palestine, funding war, funding UK's border and prison apparatus, or funding companies complicit in environmental extractivism, forcibly removing people off of their land and putting people in a perpetual cycle of homelessness and or being forced into becoming refugees. Not linking these issues together, unfortunately, illustrates the limits within current UCU strike action and more broadly, the current British union movement in general. Tonight's panel discussion is intended to bridge together discussions on marketized higher education to include migrant students and university staff voices drawing from an anti-imperialist, anti-racist, and the radical possibilities of disruptive acts. URBC is pleased to have a very excellent panel that will be speaking on such issues as critiquing the UK sanctuary scholarship movement, how right-wing and pro-Israeli free speech campaigns are attempting to limit Palestine organizing on campus, and how to successfully resist such incursions. And of course, last but not least, how migrant students and staff can organize and win workplace demands, drawing from the lessons of the successful 10-week Columbia TA strike. Tonight's event is recorded, and we will share the discussion on YouTube and on our social networks. We hope all attendees will please keep muted and not use your video function in order to ensure that we have a very seamless sort of, we don't have any Wi-Fi problems or anything that will disrupt today's event. There will be a Q&A session after the panelists are finished, and we will allow panelists to pose questions to each other first before we open up for a general Q&A discussion with attendees. We invite people to please use the chat function to write their questions to the panelist. So without further ado, the first person who will be speaking is Khalfan Al-Badwawi. Khalfan is an Omani anti-imperialist political activist. He participated in the Arab Spring uprising in 2011 and subsequently participated in organizing a number of demonstrations and campaigns against British imperialist policies and the tyrannical Anglo-Sultanic regime of Oman. After that, he was persecuted, kidnapped, arrested, and imprisoned and tortured several times in Oman, which led him fleeing the country in 2013 and sought political asylum in the United Kingdom in 2014, which he was granted in middle of 2016. Today, he lives as a political refugee in Britain, where he continues his activism by exposing British complicity in the repression in Oman. Khalfan is now completing his undergraduate studies at the School of Oriental and African Studies in London, where he's studying history on a sanctuary scholarship. And without further ado, please give the floor to Khalfan to speak. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Sanaz, for this beautiful introduction. And thank you for Unis Resist Border Controls for the incredible organizing. I would like to express my gratitude at the first to SAWAS Student Union and especially Ella Spencer for their brilliant support and solidarity. Thank you both very much. Before I start, I would like to share some basic ideas that my contribution will be centered around. First, as we know, neoliberalism was developed in the aftermath of the Second World War, and as an ideology, it emphasizes the individual freedom and rights. The argument put forward by the Western ruling class to support this ideology is that it will allow people, if they work hard, to be rich or move upwards in the social hierarchy. However, the fact is that we cannot have an equal situation as long as we enter it unequally. This links us to the second concept of the category refugee. And briefly, we know that, at least in the UK, that strengthening and expanding the immigration system came with Britain wars in early 2000s in Iraq, Afghanistan, Somalia, and other parts of the world. In 2012, and under Conservative Party policy, Home Secretary Theresa May launched comprehensive administrative and legislative measures to create, as she, and I quote here, a really hostile environment for illegal immigrants, end quote. The Immigration Act of 2014 expanded provisions to prevent landlords, employers, NHS, charities, community interest firms, and banks from providing services to individuals without legal status, and to punish them with hefty financial fines if they broke this law. These both ideas combined together will give us an initial glimpse and a direction to understand the challenges that experienced by asylum seekers and refugees in the higher education UK, the subject of our discussion today. Of course, not all these challenges are stemmed from the university rigid bureaucratic system, but universities have the choice of mitigating or solving these challenges by their means. The hostile environment does start once we put our feet into this island, what it being called the prison island, where the people who are still profiting from the remnant of colonial looting glorify law and order to control others. The immigration law, therefore, acts as a reinforcer of racial disparity between members of British society, whereby the white British are more privileged. The national bureaucratic system is being designed not to take into account the other, who does not fit in the dominant population. Whiteness is the normative in the UK. The country of freedom, of rights and law, and in the name of these slogans, has systematically deprived asylum seekers and refugees from day one of their humanity. After a brief period of tensions, asylum seeker has to enter a period of uncertainty that might last 4 years. I met people who were waiting for 9 years. For me, it was 2.5 stagnant and unproductive years of my life. Boredom, lots and lots of it, standing in queue for food in the church every Sunday, refused service in many pubs. EDL is marching every Saturday morning in the city center with police protection. Stopped and searched by police 3 times. Systematically improvised in all aspects, materially, mentally, and socially. So, after years of state-sanctioned violence, years of uncertainty, and constant psychological warfare, and by linking the new liberal idea of having ambition of working hard, be rich easily, a majority of asylum seekers will come out hating education, and the few remaining will try, after years of work and some basic education, to qualify to enter a university. Of course, we must bear in mind that the majority of refugees, after obtaining the refugee visa, will not have any capital to pay the rent deposit and thus obtain a fixed address to register at the university, and therefore to obtain a student loan. If someone managed to obtain temporary housing, registration obstacles in other places will hinder obtaining at least a student loan. In Sanaz, where I study, in 2015, Century Scholarship was formed after pressure from student-led campaign Education Beyond Borders, where they demanded SAWAS to acknowledge its colonial origins and provide places for refugees. As a result, SAWAS initiated a scheme, initially then, to provide just 7 scholarships per year. The scholarship consists of a tuition fee waiver and a maintenance loan of £6,000 per year, which is extremely insufficient for London living and has pushed refugee students into difficult struggles. These installments were always delayed by the finance department, as each installment can take some time, 4 months to be paid, as it happened to me this year when I got paid after a month from the start of the second term. Last year, SAWAS stopped the scheme and reinstated this year for the next academic year with only 2 fully funded places. So they removed 5 places. Additionally, students with unclear and unstable immigration status will have difficulty registering with a GP and accessing medical evidence, which is a requirement for being granted deadline extensions under the mitigating circumstances policy. With the total lack of mental health support available to refugee students and the likelihood of previous experience that have an ongoing impact on their mental well-being, there are no measures in place to mitigate this. In addition to the poor material structure available to students on this scheme, there is no general support structure. Some are given accommodation assistance, meaning that they don't have to spend their maintenance loan on rent. Others have only £6,000 to cover rent, food, and the general expenses of being alive. In addition, students with unstable immigration status are likely to be navigating language barriers, painful university and state bureaucracy, complex mental health needs on top of racism, discrimination, and harassment. With SAWAS pride in being a decolonial and progressive institution with a focus on the global south, the challenges for refugees in the UK should be immediate. But SAWAS uses the sanctuary scholarship to project an image of itself as progressive and decolonial institution to the world, essential to its marketing for prospective students. As it has been maintained by Unis Resist Border Controls, that sanctuary scholarship programs also are used by management to conveniently ignore the dangers of the hostile environment policy on migrant staff and students within UK higher education. SAWAS director Adam Habib's new strategic plan sets out a vision for a reinvigorated SAWAS as a hub for global citizenry and partner for institutions in the global south. Instead of granting scholarships for students from elite institutions in the global south that will only serve to reproduce the existing status quo and generate profit for SAWAS. At the end, it is important to emphasize that we can't have equal situation as long we enter it unequally. And in the case of SAWAS, inequality is sustained and reproduced as an agent for the Home Office in this oppressive regime. The immigration system has to be abolished, and refugees do not have to redouble their efforts in many aspects or beg for their basic rights or even small support, just to be treated normally as a human or as humans. Let us dream and work for a new world where people are treated with their full humanity and dignity anywhere and everywhere. Thank you for listening. Love and solidarity.
Thank you so much for that inspirational talk. Khalfan, you really set the mood for today's session. It's amazing what you've said. I just want to alert people onto the chat box that we've just gone live with Khalfan's, there's an event, a campaign that's been set up by Unis Resist Border Controls and SOAS Student Union, and it's hashtag no sanctuary at SOAS, which is of course to alert everyone about the real issues going on with the sanctuary scholarship program at SOAS and everything that Khalfan has eloquently outlined. So I hope everyone can, definitely sign the letter before you leave. The link is in the chat box. Thank you so much. Right, without further ado, the next person to speak is Raylan. Raylan is a third year PhD student at Columbia University studying early modern literature in the English department. First as a teaching assistant and later as an instructor of record, she participated in both strikes organized by student workers of Columbia in 2021, as well as a campaign to build a rank and file union in the summer. In the 10-week long strike that began in November 2021, Raylan and other colleagues organized instructors who taught first year writing at Columbia, the largest contingent of instructors of record who withheld their labor. She is planning to write her dissertation on labor and politics in early modern English literature. And without further ado, I give the floor to Raylan. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Raylan. Thank you so much for the invitation, and thank you, Khalfan, for that amazing talk. I feel like my contribution, truly, I feel like I'm still a novice in terms of learning about how to be an activist. And I think this past year, 2021, was truly an education for me. And hopefully I'll be able to share some of my experience from this past year and that this North American kind of experience might be useful, and some of our strategies and strategies and tactics may be borrowed in direct actions for you in the UK. Okay, so let me quickly introduce the background of our strike in 2021. So we are a labor union, and we were in bargaining with Columbia for over 2 years with very little gain. Columbia was stalling and stonewalling with every strategy they could manage. So in the spring of 2021, we had a strike, which was actually really not the first one. We've had so many strikes just to get our union recognized. We had to strike to get them to the bargaining table. But in the spring of 2021 was our strike to get our core demands, which were a living wage, better health benefits, including dental health, better parental leave programs, better childcare subsidies, also full unit recognition, no matter whether you're casualized, that is hourly worker, or you're worker on appointment, and most importantly, third-party neutral occupation. This point is extremely important for several reasons. One, in cases of discrimination and harassment, whether it's based on race, gender, or any other protected category, a lot of times university, when it's investigating itself, likes to protect its own kind, right? We have learned about this most recently from the case at Harvard, where 38 professors, very prominent scholars, signed a letter to protect their colleague who has been accused of sexual harassment. So we wanted to have third-party neutral arbitration, which is standard for employees, and we are employees of the university. I teach an entire class by myself. So we needed this kind of workplace protection because cases of discrimination, bullying, harassment have been really rampant at Columbia as well, as you can imagine, as the case with any of these institutions. So in the spring, we were on strike for only 3 weeks. We were actually doing quite well, but unfortunately, our strike was called off undemocratically by our union leadership. That was really a point for me of a lot of disillusionment, anger, and a lot of hopelessness, because we felt like we had sacrificed so much financially, emotionally, our relationship with our advisors, with our students. But just when we were going to get what we were asking for, the strike was called off. And this is because I think there was a real disconnect between the union leadership, that is our parent organization, UAW, as well as our bargaining committee, and between the rank and file members. And this is a problem that's quite prevalent, I think, among US labor unions. And that is why within UAW, there has been this effort of reform of passing the one member, one vote, reform measure. This is not our unique problem, but really our strike, when it was very powerful, was sabotaged. And the union leadership agreed to a tentative agreement or a contract that was really not in favor of for us. We did not win any of our core demands, not third-party neutral arbitration, not full unit recognition, and not a living wage, no dental health coverage, and not to mention our demands for social justice issues, which we wanted to be included in side letters. After this, this disappointment, we were actually able to regroup over the summer. As labor organizer Jay McLevy has said, that labor organizing is all about structure tests. That is things like actions that you put on that make people more connected, and really like build channels of communication, build a rank and file leadership. And we were really able to do that through the structure test of the spring. It was almost like a test run for our later, much longer strike. Over the summer, we canvassed for and elected a rank and file bargaining committee that won overwhelming majority of our voting members. We passed a new bylaw that ensured more clear and transparent processes and more accountability between union leadership and rank and file members. And because we were able to go through the spring strike, I think a lot of us who were still in the mindset that like, oh, we are doing this in solidarity with the labor movement, in fact realized that of course, like, we are workers because of the ways in which Colombia retaliated against us. And then in the beginning of summer, in anticipation of another strike by us, Colombia unilaterally changed our pay structure. So usually we would get our stipend in the beginning of the fall semester. And a lot of us were counting on that to start to pay rent, because a lot of us accrue debt over the summer because we're not paid enough. But they unilaterally changed that, and we were to be paid bi-weekly. So a lot of us began the semester with debt, with a lot of financial precarity. And also now they were able to completely withhold any financial income if we were to strike, including both wages and stipend. So the 10-week strike was extremely difficult, but also it was quite a galvanizing moment. I think because we had the spring strike, we were able to keep the strike together. We built better solidarity networks. We had better fundraising efforts for our mutual aid fund. We were able to distribute that money to people who need it in a much more systematic and timely manner. We had a better communications team. We had a really put together press team. We had more strategies in terms of escalating the strike. Instead of just picketing the center of campus, we had one day marching from 168th Street in New York to 116, which are the two major campuses of Columbia University. And of course, the northern part of the campus is the product of gentrification and displacement of local Harlem residents. So a part of our goal was not only to earn better protections for us, but also to hold Columbia accountable for the kind of negative impact it has had on the neighborhood, on the city, and also really in the world, right? Because Columbia is a very rich and powerful institution. That march really gained us a lot of notoriety. And then we had another really big action that was right after Colombia announced that they would not hire back anyone who's on strike, basically a kind of a lockout. So we had a shutdown strike where we, instead of having soft pickets, we had basically hard pickets in the two main entrances and also softer pickets in the other entrances. So there was a picket from, I think, 8 a.m. to 5 p.m. that entire day by every entrance. And in anticipation of that, Columbia actually moved classes online in order, because our action really generated fear in them. And I think because the reason why we're able to do that is because we built all these solidarity networks. We were able to have people, so many people join us on the picket line because we were able to have so many people join us on the picket line because we were able to really message effectively with undergrads and undergraduates who stood by us and walked on the picket line with us. We were able to message effectively to faculty who are not casualized, who are tenured, to stand by us and walk with us, that they are not a part of management. And in fact, we are fighting for their academic freedom and as well. And we were able to ally ourselves with residents in Harlem whose really livelihoods have been completely disrupted by Columbia's expansion project in their neighborhood. We were able to ally ourselves with local unions. The Teamsters came actually with a huge inflatable. They also walked with us. Their neighbors on the Upper West Side walked with us. People from all over the city, even from out of the state, coming to join us. And I think it was because of that Columbia was finally backing down little by little in the final weeks of the strike. And I think that really is the most important point that I want to convey. That is for us, especially for, I am an international student, that's what we call migrant scholars here in North America, because we have all these precarities that we have to deal with, right? Like visa, money, like the fear of really being kicked out of the country with very little notice, which actually happened in the summer of 2020 when the Trump administration said that because classes are gonna be online, there's no reason for people to be in this country and they need to, quote, go back home, even though for me, home really is here. So because of all that kind of precarity, it's especially important to build allyship. Not only with people who have more privilege in the same institutions who are working with us, people who have citizenship, people who are in faculty positions, and also with local communities. I think it's super important to recognize that these struggles are shared and see our shared purposes. Now that we have our tentative agreement, which really included most of our core demands, except for a couple of them, we are actually preparing to continue the fight. We are now building more solidarity networks. We're going to help hopefully be adjuncts at Columbia to form their own union. We are now working closely with residents in Harlem who have this organization called United Against Displacement, that is this group against gentrification. We build a relationship with local churches and temples who are so generous to open their door to us during the strike when we did not want to have classes on campus, because that's kind of the point of a strike, right? Shut down the factory. And we were also able to build relationships with local business owners who supplied our strike lunch. And we also are trying to reach out to other higher ed workers as well as unionized workers in the city. So this is kind of my experience striking for a total of 4 months almost in 2021. And hopefully some of this can be useful to you. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Raylan. That is just so incredible what you've been able to do, how you've been able to galvanize not just teaching assistants, but the whole community. And I think that's such a great way to sort of look at this. It's just really very positive. And I think we have a lot in the UK to learn from all of you in Colombia. So thank you so much for sharing all that insightful information that was just amazing. Thank you again. Our last speaker, last but not least, is Shad Abu Salema. And she is a Palestinian academic born and raised in the Jabalia refugee camp in northern Gaza. But she's now based in Sheffield and is teaching at the Media Arts and Communication Department at Sheffield Hallam University. She has recently submitted her PhD dissertation on the historical representation of Palestinian refugees in Gaza between 1917 and 1993. She is an artist, an activist, and an author of Palestine From My Eyes blog, and a co-founder of the London-based Hawaiia Dance Company. Thank you so much, Shad, for joining us, and the floor is yours now. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Sanaz, for such a brilliant introduction, and thank you for previous speakers for all your insights. I was listening and feeling very motivated by it. So my story happens to come now at the forefront of our UCU strike, which is currently taking place. Took place yesterday and the day before, and it's again next week. And I'm not sure how much people here know, but I'll just give an overview of what I've been going through since Christmas, when I became basically, when I transitioned through my university system from being a student to being in charge of full module under associate lecturer position. So on Christmas Eve, literally just before our university and everyone went on holiday, I continued to deal with a headache that was brought before my eyes through a publication called Jewish News. And we have to point here that Jewish in that title is very ideological construction. It is a very pro-Israel group that is using Judaism to sort of construct this analogy between anti-Zionism and anti-Zionism in order to protect Israel from accountability and deflect from their from Israeli apartheid consistent crimes against the Palestinians, which I was born into that, you know, oppressive situation in Gaza, which is now known as the world's largest open air prison, the most frequently bombarded, that people cannot even swim for it because, you know, Israeli military is besieging us from land, sea, and air. And basically Jewish News had informed me then that my university is investigating me over charges of anti-Semitism that were completely baseless. I mean, now I'm talking to you from a position where I emerged victorious, thanks to tens of thousands around the world, literally, who spoke up in my support. The fact that they went on holiday while I had to deal with that news gave me a bit of time to sort of, you know, let people know and contact the organizations locally, but also, you know, any group that I've connected with throughout my journey from Palestine to the UK, and letting them know that there's potentially something that is going to jeopardize my position at university and, of course, tarnish my reputation and my credibility, my academic as well, credibility. And I fought it as anyone would, being in that situation, having basically my life at stake, my whole future at stake. I'm only 30 years old, young academic, barely starting. And I was teaching a module, I was supposed to teach a module on post-colonial media culture, interestingly, that is, we see now basically like represented in my case, and the fact that unfortunately colonialism is not a culture of the past, it is a present reality that the Palestinians are dealing with. And it's easy for us to see how, you know, like these intersecting discourses of violence that are trapping us in this oppressive situation, whether we're in Palestine or outside Palestine. And in my case, Israeli oppression in the form of intellectual terrorism, let's say, and smearing and the intimidation that I've been receiving is basically an evidence of this consistent demonization that the Palestinians have been dealing with since the turn of the 20th century and even before. In my case, yes, we managed to turn the tide and we reversed the punishment basically that I received from my university. I was kept in the dark for nearly a month between the first article that told me that I was being investigated and the email that I received from my university saying that a complaint was handed in and an investigation is going to be carried out and my students are going to be informed that my classes are canceled until further notice. And in the same time, the university sent the students a very vague email without providing any context saying the classes are canceled due to unforeseen circumstances. And obviously I was being silenced and demonized and harassed and my perspective was completely dismissed. I have to remind here that I'm a member of Sheffield Hallam University since 2017. So I've been in this university for 4 years, one of its most active students as a PhD, but I was also, as part of my PhD, I was teaching. So some of you may be aware about how some, you know, scholarships are given, the funding of it is basically conditioned upon teaching. And so we end up being teaching on top of researching. And I was doing that, but I was also organizing on a student level across universities. Two main universities are here in Sheffield. And I was also organizing with the UCU and with all community groups that are interested in social justice and international social justice. And of course, freedom and justice for Palestine. So it came as a shock to me when my university, after 4 years of you know, devoted member of its institution, they would treat me like that. And I found myself caught up in a net of bureaucratic and political injustices. And because of the UCU, the current UCU strike and the current debate, it's probably important to note that that I was basically treated as a worker. And when the university received that complaint from external actors, they didn't have me even on their records as an employee. They didn't have me. So like for them, I didn't exist. I was no, or I did exist, but I wasn't anyone that they were accountable to. And so I was treated like nobody with no rights, nothing. And like the university completely ignored any protocol and completely ignored its own duties to its staff and student members. And we also have to emphasize that, of course, when I am being suspended, when I was suspended, my students were affected in the process. And for 2 weeks, their education was disrupted. This is a flagrant violation of the university code of conduct and its duties to its staff and students. And for the university to disrupt my life and disrupt the students' education in order to appease Zionist supporters or let's say apologists for Israeli apartheid, it's just outrageous. I'm so proud that I'm talking to you now with the situation from a place of power, really, because I am now being reinstated. I have been already back to teaching. However, the intimidation and the harassment and the demonization and the smears are still continuing, and the pressure continues against my university as well to reverse its decision by reinstating me. There's so much to speak here, but I would like to emphasize some of the positive side to this story that I kept clinging on to stay strong and keep on fighting. And this positive side needs to be emphasized. And this is the side that actually saved me and made literally an unprecedented victory on UK campuses. So the students' support have been amazing. There were more than 200 student societies across the country that signed a letter of support, emphasizing how the IHRA definition of anti-Semitism is basically an unfit for purpose, is unfit for purpose, and it's only fueling racism and ethno-religious divisions on campus, and it's also a flagrant violation of freedom of speech and academic freedom, which are values that should be, you know, like the basis of any academic institution. And it's probably important, I'm not sure, Sanaz, has the IHRA definition been discussed already as part of this talk?
No, actually. I mean, if you want to give a very brief, within 1 minute time frame, that would be great.
Okay, so the IHRA definition has been pushed from government officials in the UK And I, as far as I understand, it's been an experience that has been replicated across many Western countries. But basically here within our context, Gavin, the ex-education minister, literally threatened universities with funding cuts if they didn't adopt the IHRA definition. And if this doesn't show how politically motivated it is, then what does? The IHRA definition focuses more on fighting criticisms of Israel rather than Jews. So all you need to know is that 7 out of 11 examples are listed under the definition as potentially anti-Semitic have to do with the Israeli state. And one of them says blatantly that calling Israel a racist endeavor is anti-Semitic. And that, I mean, is just unacceptable and outrageous, and is and within it there is an embodiment of the denial of the Palestinian experience. Zionism as an ideology is a supremacist racist ideology that have informed the building of the Israeli state, and has also basically informed the ethnic cleansing of the Palestinians in 1948, a process that continues until now, and we see it in Sheikh Jarrah, in the Jordan Valley, in Hebron, in Gaza, even in the frequent bombardments of Gaza. This ethnic cleansing is a crime, and also let's remind that Amnesty International has also published a report recently calling Israel an apartheid state. And of course, when we're thinking of an apartheid, we're thinking of racism. And this is a context that I grew up under, where basically the Palestinians are the indigenous people of the land are being eliminated, suppressed, and dehumanized in every form since even before the formation of the Israeli state on the ruins of Palestine. That is why I grew up a refugee in Jabalia refugee camp, a third generation. And that the continued denial of our right to self, our right to self-determination and freedom, and even the right to return to our dispossessed lands that fall in what is called nowadays Israel, is also a form of racism. Also the UCU has been fundamental in reversing this smear attack and protecting me. And I just think in as a concluding marks, like we have to remember that we need to act as a collective, and we have a lot more in common than what divides us. And our oppressors are literally united against our oppression. Like, for example, Israel is supporting other oppressive regimes with military exchange and expertise and whatnot, and technology and surveillance and all these things in order for them to use it against their unwanted others. And we've seen that in different contexts, in Kashmir, in the US, in Yemen. We've seen that in so many places. And so, like, for us as oppressed, as people who are vulnerable vulnerable to so many discourses of violence, whether in my case I'm also a refugee in this country, so like even my migrational status could be affected, with these smears that are not even painting me as an anti-Semite, but I'm also being painted as a terrorist. And in the latest, for example, article that came in the Jewish Chronicle, I was, the Jewish Chronicle, it's very infamous, Islamophobic, racist, pro-Israel publication that shouldn't be taken seriously at all. But they have also painted me as a daughter of a convicted terrorist. My father is a freedom fighter who have spent 15 years of captive resistance in Israeli jails. And only a month after I was born, my house was raided in the middle of the night with Israeli forces, dozens of them breaking into the house, terrorizing my family and flipping everything upside down, stealing whatever they could, and then kidnapping my father for 6 months under administrative detention for no charge and no trial. And these are just like a snapshot into how I came to life, really. Thank you. I'm sorry for my long contribution. Thank you for listening.
Thank you so much, Shad. Thank you so much. And thank you for joining us. And that's a very sobering explanation about what is happening currently in Palestine historically. But also, I think you talk a little bit about, of course, the UCU branch. I think I want to make a differentiation, Shad, just so that, you know, because it's been UCU Sheffield Hallam that's been very supportive of you. And I believe UCU Sheffield, which is the University of Sheffield's UCU branch, but not, I don't, and I think maybe you can clarify, but in the chat box, but it's been basically those two branches of the national UCU. It's not been national UCU, but it's been the two UCU. Yes, I think that would be, if you can make a clarification. Just one note for everyone, if you can please close your videos. We just need the videos to be closed just for technical reasons. Thank you so much. This is gonna be the Q&A session. So I would like to have Raylan and Khalfan open their videos. And we're gonna have a conversation between Shad, Raylan, and Khalfan for the next 10 minutes or so before we open it up for the rest of everyone else who's attended to give their questions and answers. If you can please use the chat box if you have a question, that'd be great. Thank you so much. So all of you have been talking, and I think there's a real interconnecting point in the fact that all of you have talked about the importance of making links, of making interconnections, of reaching out. And I think the other issue is around looking beyond, not just looking at, for example, Raylan, you talked about, well, you know, what you were going through was a labor issue, but you involved the rest of the community because of the gentrification, that Columbia University has been complicit in doing and forcing people out of their homes. And the same as well, Khalfan, you talked about the immigration situation, but also looking at it as, you know, we all need to come together to understand this. You know, it's impacting migrants, refugees, asylum seekers, undocumented people, but it also trickles down as well into how it affects British society in general. And Shad, the same thing from you just now, looking at, you know, looking at your situation, but in how quick you were able to galvanize support, and how the union, the UCU branch at Sheffield Hallam, but also countless organizations on the ground, a lot of the Palestine organizations, student Palestine organizations across the UK were able to galvanize support. So I think it's really important to sort of look at that. So I guess any comments you want to say in regards to that? I'll open up to Khalfan and then Raylan to give a brief, and then Shad last. Khalfan, anything else you want to add to that?
I mean, it was beautiful and incredible talks by Raylan and Shahad. And it's very interesting how in London, at least, we don't have the university link with a community. It's kind of, they are disconnected, where it is beautiful to see Colombia, they have that connection with the outside communities and work with them.
Maybe Raylan, can you tell us how you were able to make those connections? I think that's really important to maybe talk about how you're able to come to the community without, you know, being extractivist, because sometimes I think that generally does happen, unfortunately, within the US, but even in here in the UK. So maybe if you can tell us a little bit about how you were able to do that.
Yeah, I've not been as much involved with the Solidarity Working Group, so I'm not sure how we first got in touch, for example, with Harlem residents. But I think we were able to think about our shared purpose, right? So they came to our picket lines. And also we had members educating us and speaking to us during our rallies. And we have been going now to protests that they've been organizing. So I think it's really about standing up for each other and standing in solidarity with one another. And I think truly like the conflict between Columbia University and the neighborhood has been ongoing, right? Like for decades and decades. And even in the 1968 Columbia uprising, I think a huge, so that's a part of the history, right? Like of Columbia, of activism at Columbia. In the 1968 uprising, one of the catalysts was that Columbia University wanted to take up this land in a public park and build a gym, basically. So expanding into like more of Harlem and then building a gym that the top part is apparently for Columbia affiliates, and then the bottom half would be for local residents. So basically they called it the new Jim Crow. So that was an important catalyst. So I feel like activism at Columbia has had a long history of being in partnership with our neighbors. And we have that to give thanks to.
That's a good point to talk about. Shad, I think it would be interesting to know, like, how do we, you know, when we talk about building solidarity, how is that done, you know?
Yeah, I mean, consistency, grassroots work is very important. And I've been basically doing this work ever since I was, you know, in Gaza, I was doing that, but also ever since I stepped foot in this country, I was always looking for, you know, for people who support Palestine. And you know, I have family still there. My niece has recently survived another attack on Gaza in May, and she was barely two at that time. And one of her first words were like Saruch, which meant missile, and it's just heartbreaking to see new generations of Palestinian refugees still born under the same oppressive situations. So, and we have to do whatever we can, whatever in our capacity, in order to build solidarity for Palestine. And I was doing that, you know, and with so many venues. I was started first on my blog, Palestine From My Eyes. But then I was also on the same time mobilizing on the ground with Palestinian families of political prisoners, hearing their stories, writing about them, making these untold stories more visible. And then here in London, as soon as I stepped foot, I was building also more venues, galvanizing more support for Palestine through Hawiya, for example. Like by now we established that in 2017, but by now we like danced the Palestinian folk dance of Dabke to like tens of thousands of audiences around the UK. And it's just an amazing way to get people, you know, engaged in Palestine and getting them curious to know this other side to the story that they only see, you know, when people are being killed in massive numbers and suddenly Palestine on the headlines. But also here in Sheffield has been monumental in terms of supporting me in the past period. And for me, you know, like mental health issues are part of our daily lives. We are dealing with a huge storm. And of course, injustice is part of our everyday experience. And we feel it under our skin. And so like we need those solidarity groups in order to be able to function, to survive. And my way of dealing with my mental health, honestly, is by mobilizing and galvanizing and speaking up against all this oppression that continues without accountability.
And I was gonna say that I think it's important to even draw, like, for example, whether it's Khalfan with what's the situation in Oman or the situation, like, for example, you know, even looking at worker issues as, you know, an element, because a lot of the workers, we know that, you know, whether it's in New York City or whether it's in London or whether it's in Sheffield or whether it's, I'm based in Manchester, it's, you know, a lot of the workers are migrants and they are, you know, here in the UK because they have been oppressed back home, whether it's oppressed because of politics, whether it's oppressed because of economic sanctions, whether it's oppressed by a variety of different things, and drawing those linkages. And, you know, the same is true when we do any type of border abolition work as part of Unis Resist Border Controls. We see it as an element of showing solidarity for those who are oppressed in the global south because of foreign policy issues, because of colonialism, because of imperialism, because of all of these issues that have not ended. And of course, as Khalfan mentioned earlier in his talk, you know, the hostile environment policy that we now see is an extension of this racist, xenophobic colonialism that has never left the UK, in addition to what's been happening in Palestine, in addition to what's happening across the world. So I think it's important to draw those links so that people understand these are not separate issue, but they're all interconnected. And this is why our mobilization has to be equally interconnected as well. I want to just to like say there is a question in the chat box, and I'll pose this to Khalfan, Raylan, and Shad, if you want to give some extra points, and I'll say some stuff at the end. The question is, how can universities oppose hostile environment, especially as they are remaining apolitical? Khalfan, the floor is yours.
I think they have the choice to stop engaging with the Home Office. It's their choice. I know the government has linked it with funding, with many things, but we know that universities have the choice as well. They have a choice of duty of care to their staff and their students as well. They can do that. It's up to them. I think universities in the UK, they can come together and oppose or force the government at least to abolish at least the immigration system, all of it.
Sorry, Raylan?
Sorry, could you repeat the question real quick?
How can universities oppose hostile environment? In the beginning, I was talking about hostile environment. It's an immigration system in the UK that's been going on for over 10 years now that basically essentially treats everyday people as, if you're a British citizen, you become a border guard essentially. You have a similar process in the United States. I think maybe, how do we oppose borders on campus? Maybe I'll give you that as a general question, you know, just to start off with.
Yeah, I feel like one of the things that we've been fighting for, and our counterpart union at New York University really won, was sanctuary campus. That is ICE and NYPD off campus. They got that in their labor contract and a side letter. And this is something we've been, so ICE is immigration control, I forgot what the E stands for, but you get the drift. This is something we've been wanting to get, and we will definitely organize for in our next contract. So universities, being very powerful and very rich corporate bodies, actually have a lot of leverage. And I think them saying that they don't have any control over the situation and just follow orders is really abdicating their responsibility, right? Actually, I know like universities could, I know that over the universities have great lobbying powers, and that's how they're able to get so much funding. And if they were these institutions which are band together, they have a huge influence over policy, and they already do. It's just that their influence is not necessarily good. I wanted to take this time to kind of go back to an earlier question, like in terms of like solidarity and how to build networks without being like being extractive. And I think that like it's both important to recognize our shared purpose, but also like our differences and like really be honest about that, because I think that like the university like exploit us in different ways, right? There are ways in which I am very privileged. And I think that it's important to use your privilege to protect others, like protect and help people who have like shared purposes, but also recognize that like I am a settler, right? Like I, even though I'm disadvantaged in certain ways because I don't have citizenship, but I am a settler in multiple ways, like in this city, like, and this entire country is like a settler colonial country. So I think being honest about that really clear-eyed about how I function in the system of oppression, and like not to claim other people's struggle when my position is as an ally, I guess.
That's an excellent point. Thank you so much for saying that. That's really excellent. Shah, do you have any thoughts? Because, you know, as you say, you're a refugee, you know, you're a double refugee in a sense because of your experiences in Gaza and because of the ongoing situation there, but also here in the UK with, you know, immigration, draconian immigration, borders, that sort of thing. What are your thoughts? Like, how can universities oppose hostile environment from your perspective?
To start with, they need to ditch prevent strategy and the IHRA definition. And I feel like these strategies are not, welcome in a space such as academia. It only basically, as Sanaz said earlier, it extends these colonial and hostile and xenophobic and racist teachings of the colonial empire. And ever since I attended, I stepped foot in this country, I joined SOAS, the School of Oriental and African Studies. And that, for example, has a history of being built in order to help aid British expansion and help them understand us better, so they govern us or control us better. So like the most of, like, if you go and look deeper, you would find that Western academy is part and parcel of the oppression that has been falling out against the global South, and in the case of Palestine, which I've studied my whole life, this is like very, very clear. Academia was on the forefront of legitimating the Zionist ideology and the Israeli state, and justifying their crimes and demonizing the Palestinians and suppressing us. And until now, we are trying to shift this narrative and disrupt this colonial legacy. And with our work, we're doing this, decolonizing work, the work that is necessary in order to disrupt the status quo and this colonial legacy. I wanted to say another thing. So of course there's a connect, and in terms of like, I love that bit about recognizing your privilege and acting with it, with power. And I've seen these examples so many times, like even in my case, like when I said Sheffield was monumental, the tipping point really in my case was when the students and the UCU and members of the community, joined forces and organized this solidarity protest outside my university, coincidedly with other reporters coming to speak to me about what is going on. And that literally made, a day after that, the university reinstated me, but I refused to go back because the investigations were carried on a very wrong and racist ground that is the IHRA. And it's also nice to remember, for example, Palestine Action, an amazing movement that has been gaining a lot of momentum that reached the shutdown of the first branch of Elbit Systems in the UK. And we need to here to remind Elbit Systems is Israel's largest private arms producer, and they provide 85% of weapons that are used against Gaza. They literally, they market their weapons as battle tested, and then they come here in London, for example. There's this dicey arms fair where they present their weapons as battle tested, and then they sell it to other oppressive regimes so that they use it against their unwanted others. And these, like these Israeli, an Israeli giant arms factory that exists here in 10 branches, thankfully to the grassroots, thanks to the grassroots movement and the people who acknowledge their privilege and put their liberty on the line, riding the roofs of these arms factories and exposing how they are part of the normalization of the oppression that is befalling on daily basis against our brothers and sisters in Palestine and Kashmir and Yemen even. And is, I mean,
so many other places. And I was going to say that that was in Oldham. They shut down the Oldham Elbit plant, and it was really down to a lot of grassroots organizing, because I was quite aware of what was going on then, Shad, as I'm sure you were. It was really the people in Oldham who were able to do this incredible work, daily protesting, weekly protesting, that were able to get rid of Elbit. And I think that's a really excellent point to mention, is the arms. So when we look at, I think, you know, in terms of the question at hand, and I think when we look at how can we oppose hostile environment policy, from our perspective as Unis Resist Border Controls, I think it's a few things. It's a few multifaceted things, drawing out what Khalfan, Raylan, and Shad has mentioned. I think first off is understanding what the hostile environment policy is. When we did a survey, Unis Resist Border Controls did a survey in 2018, and it was published in The Guardian the following year. But we found that 51% of university lecturers, and this includes some students who are teaching assistants, had no knowledge of what the hostile environment policy is. So I think it's indicative of the fact that it's not discussed as much, even though we've been really trying in this strike action to get people to understand what a hostile environment policy is, and also to really help, you know, guide migrant students on supporting the strikes, because the hostile environment policy affects their migrant staff members, and it also affects migrant students. So it's one is understanding what the hostile environment policy is. Two is looking at how immigration networks work on campus in a variety of different points. So for example, you have universities investing and colluding with border and prison infrastructure, right? So about a year and a half ago, we found at Cambridge University that their certain departments at Cambridge University were actually advertising border force, they were looking for individuals within Cambridge University who were good at data analytics, were good at facial recognition software, et cetera. And they were looking for individuals who were recently graduating to join them on some type of a project they were doing to expand the border apparatus. And we publicized it thanks to a tip off from somebody within Cambridge University. But there are so many linkages with universities working, you know, either doing research for Border Force or doing research for companies that will be selling their technology to various border forces, not just the UK, but, you know, Fortress Europe, for example, Frontex. So we have to look at it from that perspective. The other thing is really understand your hostile environment policy apparatus in university, you know, asking those hard questions, having UCU ask those hard questions, do FOIs. Those are things that you can do. And I think more importantly, working with Unis Resist Border Controls, because we all have to work collectively together. And if you're organizing in your own silos, you're not going to really oppose hostile environment. I often get lecturers coming to me and they'll say, I don't take register, or I don't do this, I don't do that. And I'm like, well, you know, you might not do it in your class, but your other colleagues are doing it. So it's not as if that's going to stop the process. You might pat yourself on the back and feel better, but that's not going to end hostile environment, right? That's just one person. One person won't change. It has to be a movement. It has to be an interconnected movement where you share information, you organize consistently. It's not a one-off. And I think that's when we have to come. So if we're talking about how to organize hostile environment in UK universities, whether it's in the UK, but of course the same border policies are happening in Canada and the United States and all over Europe, it's really about working together. And again, I think that's the big kind of takeoff point from today's event is really working consistently together, sharing information, and really looking at this, not from a siloed position, because that's not going to really change anything. I think if there's about maybe 6 minutes left, is there any other questions anyone has? You can please use the chat box, list your question, or if you
on something that you just said, and maybe like
chat, go ahead. Yes,
maybe in the meantime there will be more questions, but I just thought that like not understanding this hostile environment is actually white privilege. And we have to address it as such. Like you are not talking about it because it's not affecting you. You're not seeking to understand it because it's not affecting you, but it is affecting people on daily basis. And for them to say like, oh, we don't know, this is white privilege. And so people need to literally educate themselves and be more proactive in reaching out to people who are experiencing this hostility in so many levels, and educate themselves is a really good start in acknowledging their privilege.
I think that's a great point to add, Shah. Thank you so much for that. I think it is an element of white privilege. I think it's also it's a class thing as well. If you're middle class or upper class, you can sort of erase yourself from this because you don't think the border apparatus really touches you. But it's really interesting. We've had actual academics who have been tenured, but they're facing immigration problems, or their spouses are facing immigration problems. And all of a sudden they realize, it happens to them as well. And I want to share one particular case. There was an academic, it's not always, when we talk about white privilege, it's not just the basis of your skin tone. It's your political mind, I want to mention, because this academic was a woman of color who said outright, well, why is the border force treating me this way? I contribute in the UK. I've been a full lecturer. I give lectures. I've taught at Cambridge. I've taught at these institutions. I'm at a Russell Group school. Why are they treating me this way? It's not like I'm an illegal immigrant in this country, but why are they treating me like that? And I said, well, it's not anything to do with that. I think you have to understand that, you know, the immigration laws are changing and it's becoming increasingly xenoracist to limit people who have been illegalized because of changing immigration laws. So if you think about it as, why are they treating it as an illegal, and not looking at it as why, you know, we need to have solidarity for people that have been illegalized because of the ever-changing immigration laws, the fact that visas are very expensive, the fact that regularizing your status, whether you're in the United States, whether you're in Canada, whether you're in the UK, isn't it very expensive, costly operation? And it was just astounding that this academic, who is a sociologist, couldn't understand that. And I was kind of prodding them a bit. And then it just seemed that they were like, well, I'm a useful migrant, and these people aren't useful migrants. And why are they being allowed in the country and I'm being affected? And it was very interesting conversation, but it's something that I have come across many times. So it's actually trying to burst the bubble in their head that we need to eliminate these distinctions, you know, that are basically, you know, being propped up by right-wing discourse of the grateful migrant, the useful migrant, the model migrant versus everyone else who's considered scraps and riffraff. And that's, I think, what we need to do. And what I've been doing as part of, and all of my colleagues at Unis Resist Border Controls, many of them, of course, are on this call at the moment. We've been really trying very hard just to effectively end this type of really racist and xenophobic distinctions and say, look, we are all in it together. We, you know, for example, we have some people within UCU who believe that, you know, ending hostile environment means having the university pay their visa fees and their international health surcharge fees. And we say, well, yeah, if the university does that for tenured member staff or someone who is on a contract, well, that's not ending hostile environment. That's just transferring the financial costs from the individual to the university. But you don't think the university is not going to weaponize that in some shape or form? Of course they will. And they always do in terms of immigration status. But the other thing is that, what about your refugee students? What about your undocumented students? What about your asylum seeker students? What about your migrant students? And what about your staff who are also in those situations? We need to look broadly. We need to think about the community outside the university. If you're only looking at the university, that's not ending hostile environment. That's just transferring cost. And that's not a solution. So we've always said we work in conjunction with people, all types of migrants. And we really believe this is where our politics are situated, and it needs to be. And I think anything to do with any type of migrant politics has to be situated in an anti-imperialist, obviously anti-capitalist, and anti-colonialist discourse. You can't talk about it from anything else. But I think on that note, I will end because we have come to 6:30. I just want to say a brief point. We've just put the URBC link. If you want to contact Unis Resist Border Controls, if you're in UCU and you want some strike lit info, whatever, please contact us. Our link is here. Share it on the pickets. It's really important. I think also it's just to let everyone know the work that Unis Resist Border Controls does is we do educational outreach on hostile environment and strategizing on how your university can actually help push back on hostile environment policy. We do voluntary casework for migrant students and staff who are affected because of immigration and other issues on campus. We do research on hostile environment policy. We've been doing it for now, we're coming close to 6 years that we've been operating. And last but not least, we do direct action and join forces with other migrant groups, border abolition groups, and other liberatory campaigns. So I think it's really important. Please support our work and thank everyone for coming. And of course, thank this lovely panel, Khalfan, Relaine, and Shad, for your enormous contributions. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.